Hey guys, we're back on my F2P account in the Chinese server, and this will be the last time I get to do this on expert tier because this account is now level 70. So that means I will be on masters starting next week. I'm thinking I should still do okay because right now I do already have 3 main DPS Valkyries, namely Twilight Paladin, Valkyrie Pledge, and the Hairshell of Reason. It's not yet ideal, but I think it'll do for now. So anyway, I've been dealing with a situation, and I have no idea why this is happening, but I haven't been able to properly apply Picasso in battle. And I noticed this last week against Jizo, but this time I decided to do a run with just Umbro Rose, equipped with Picasso T&M, to see if I could apply the paint consistently, and I couldn't. So I have no idea why. If anyone knows what's going on, please let me know in the Discord or in the comment section here. But for those who don't know what is expected to happen, there is a team combination where Picasso T is equipped by one support and Picasso T and M is placed on another. And with their basic attacks, we are able to apply the red paint with the first support and subsequently the yellow paint with the second support, activating the two-set ability and causing enemies to take more physical damage. Now, it can be applied by a single Valkyrie, but it will require that Valkyrie to do more basic attacks, and that's why I did what I did, but the paint was still not applying properly, and I just wanted to clear that up before going into the actual run. Just in case you guys noticed that the paint was not combining, I just want to let you know, I noticed it too. Very quickly, before that, I just wanted to update you guys on the changes with the Valkyries. So since reaching level 70, I have acquired Void Drifter's and Twilight Paladin's costume. Void Drifter's 4-star augment requires Valkyrie Ranger to be at level 70 and at SS rank. Twilight Paladin's 3 stars, which is where we get her costume, actually only requires level 60 and S rank, but I happen to get enough materials at just about the same time, so, you know, happy coincidence, I guess. Yeah, I'll try to get her to 4 stars as soon as possible because she gets 2 really useful abilities and that would be ideal for masters. Okay, going in we have Hephaestus as the first boss, and I decided to be conservative with my Valkyries. That's something I do when I'm unsure where I should be placing them. So any of my 3 main DPS could actually do Hephaestus. But I did do a run with the Hairshell of Reason, and it was pretty close to Twilight Paladin, so do bear in mind, I am keeping like anything that's elemental support for Asaka. So the Hairshell of Reason was just doing this solo. And the score wasn't that much better. In fact, it wasn't actually better. I think they got almost the same score. So I decided to go to Twilight Paladin and her team and leave my elemental DPS and supports for Asaka. I did not try Valkyrie Pledge because she is the only one of the 3 who does not have a type disadvantage against Asaka. But I also kind of forgot that the Hairshell of Reason, or Hairshells in general, just basically aren't that badly affected by type disadvantages. But we'll talk more about that later. So on this team, we have Yamabuki Armor for her physical shield. It's not really helpful because Hephaestus can actually paralyze you and the shield does not protect you from the paralysis. But Yamabuki Armor is actually here for her impair. Also because it's a basic attack, she can actually apply the red paint, but I gave up on the paint thing because like I showed you guys earlier, it was not applying and so I just went in with the combo attack just to deal a bit more damage. And then just switch Twilight Paladin out and deal as much damage as she can. So with Twilight Paladin, I'm sure you guys already understand how she works, but the general strategy is to charge up your Fervent Gauge because it's after your charge attack. With or without Kafka, it doesn't really matter that much. I mean it does, but what I'm saying is that you still do the same thing. And you're gonna charge up your Fervent Gauge, and then you're gonna switch out your supports. The tricky thing here is that you have to maintain your combo, and that's why most of the time, like with Yamabuki Armor, if you don't want to be applying your impair too soon, you go with lasers and you use only charge attacks until their switch skills are ready, and then you do the impair. So I wanted to go with Raider's Missiles, but it did not- well, it's obviously not a laser, because I do actually have Gustav Klimt M, so I went with that other laser, I think it's called Cathode 06 or something like that, and that allowed me to maintain my combo and still apply impair and use a weapon skill before switching out. So even though I didn't really have Picasso, I did at least have the Impair from Yamabuki Armor and Gustav Klimt M at, well, level 35, but still it's Gustav Klimt M. So that is basically all the physical support I'm getting, which would see me through at least like the charge attack and the first combo sequence, I guess. So that is actually quite a bit of damage. And I managed to use my enhanced charge attack from Twilight Paladin at about 165 combo because I don't have enough critical hits. I couldn't really maintain the fervent state for that long. So that was the best damage output I could go for. And then I switch back into Yamabuki Armor and, you know, activate the QTE again because I want the Global Time Fracture to slow the time down. And so at this point, Twilight Paladin has done enough attacks to actually have enough SP for her ultimate, which I use to get back into the Fervent State. So given that I'm not at 4-star Augment, it does not recharge my Fervent bar, but it still does allow me to enter the Fervent State even without using a charge attack. It just has something like a 2-second delay. So if you are using Twilight Paladin, which is, you know, anything from 1 to 3 stars, that's something that you should look out for. Okay, and let's move on to Asaka. And so I tried different strategies. At this point, I already tried a team with Valkyrie Pledge to kind of come in and do some damage with Judah. Also to attempt to break one of the arms and leave one of the other arms. Wait a minute, what? I mean, break one of the arms and leave the other arm for the Hiyasha reason. God, how many arms does it have? Anyway, so yeah, that was the main focus, to like kind of use Judah to focus down one of the arms, of course with the help of the Hiyasha reason's initial attacks when charging up her construction, and then, you know, leave the other arm to the Hiyasha reason. But in general, you know, I tried that, it did not work. So I tried this other team with Flame Sakitama because she does have the incomplete version of Florid Sakura, but it does still have that active skill that does the elemental debuff. And so I thought if I stack that with Blood Dance and then, you know, use the Hiyasha of Reason to kind of work off that damage, it could work really well. But unfortunately, having the Hiyasha of Reason on the field the whole time actually is even faster than trying to apply all those elemental debuffs, which is weird, but it worked, so I stuck with that. So anyway, despite having like really strong burst damage, the Hiyasha of Reason does have a lot of advantages for staying in the field for a long period of time because, you know, she can charge her ultimate. Basically, she does have an increased SP charging rate, so she charges her SP faster than most Valkyries. And even in like really advanced tiers, people also use her to charge up her ultimate, then they switch out for elemental supports and then switch in to use her ultimate. But the other strength that she has is charging her construction with ultimate evasions, as you just saw on the screen, and that helps with her damage output a lot. Because normally you would have to go through all her combo sequences just to get to that drill attack to really charge up 2 bars of construction. But with one ultimate evasion, and that motion is just so quick, you know, it's just one dodge and you get a bar of construction, and that allows you to increase your damage output exponentially. And that's where, you know, in a lower tier, she doesn't really need the support Valkyries because that's just wasting her time, unless the support Valkyries can also cover the time with time fractures, and that allows them to do whatever it is they have to and not consume time by switching out and wasting your main DPS's time. Unfortunately, I don't have a team that can do that, so I stuck with the best course of action. Anyway, you know, just doing that got me into 0.99%, already better than last week. Of course, I did do quite a few upgrades, and I'm like 1,000 points away from the 100th position, and that's pretty cool. So anyway, since I did not have to use Judah, my Lightning, Elemental Stigmata, or Valkyrie Pledge, I decided to go back and try on Hephaestus because Valkyrie Pledge is actually really, really suited to be a DPS against Hephaestus. And the first thing I did, I don't really remember why I did that. I think it's because Twilight Paladin just has so many hits, and I wanted to try it out, so I put Judah and all the Lightning, Elemental Stigmata on Twilight Paladin and used her against Hephaestus. Well, the score was significantly better than when I was using physical damage, but, you know, eventually I did actually put all the equipment back on Valkyrie Pledge, and I guess it really shows that Valkyrie Pledge is still the best fit for Judah, because Twilight Paladin I think has the most hits among all the 30s of battlesuits, and if Valkyrie Pledge can still beat that at only S rank, then it's safe to say that the damage output also comes from Valkyrie Pledge and it's not just from Judah. So anyway, since I did not need any elemental support stigmata that were applied on hit, I brought Jing Shentan T and B back over to this team and put them on Umbral Rose because she does a QTE switch in, and I put Roel Amundsen's full set on Yamabuki armor. I did the same with the team with Valkyrie Triumph, so you know, because they don't have to come out on the field. And yeah, anyway, back to this fight. So Valkyrie Pledge managed to do a lot more damage in a shorter amount of time than Twilight Paladin did, and because of that, she could skip the invulnerability phase that Hephaestus will activate at a certain HP threshold, and that saves you a lot of time. So for Twilight Paladin, I did actually come out on the second rotation with her charge attack because it deals like a flurry of hits, but it was all blocked by the invulnerability phase, and that's why it was that much slower. So I'm close to 0.2%, but I don't think there's any way for me to push like any further. So I'm pretty happy with the score that I have because this is only a 3-month old account, and we'll see how I do when I go to Masters next week. So I know I can't cover a lot of different situations because the Valkyries that I have are going to be different from what a lot of other people have with their F2P accounts, but I hope that, you know, from the way I'm handling the Memorial Arena, you can at least see stuff like how I build up to like the last attempt. Which, for Asaka, I did just Flame Sakitama and like a random Valkyrie, I think it was White Comet, because she's like, I don't really need her in either bosses, and she's strong enough to clear the first 4 tries, but I don't really need her on the 5th try either, so then I could bring my main team in, try out, and exit the stage before my points get locked in, and then I can see the extent of my team's capabilities, but more importantly, it will show me how I want to manage the team. You know, who goes to what boss, like what I did with Valkyrie Pledge. So I tried on Asaka, she didn't really work, I exited the stage so that she wasn't locked on Asaka, and then I finally decided to put her back on Hephaestus, and also that's because Hephaestus has the 20% additional score, and you really want to focus on that, you really want to max out on whatever bonuses you have in any kind of situation. So yeah, that's pretty much it. I hope you guys have at least, you know, got something out of the video. Or maybe it's just entertainment for you, in which case I'm also fine with that. And for people who have been asking on whether or not I will be polling for the new S-rank Seele battlesuit, on the Chinese server, I'll probably just do a 10-time pull if I manage to get enough crystals before the expansion ends. It's very likely that I will, but I probably wouldn't do a video on it because I'm not expecting to get her. If I do though, I will do a video on it, obviously. But I will definitely be pulling for her on the Southeast Asian server, and I will be doing an event on the channel, so do stay tuned for that. That, you know, you guys can actually take part and share in with my luck with the RNG. So if you're wondering what that's all about, just stay tuned because I will be updating you guys in a future video. So until then, this has been MG, thank you guys for watching, and I will see you guys soon.